Java modifiers. Like other languages, it is possible to modify classes, methods, etc. by using modifiers. There are two categories of modifiers. One, the access modifiers, which include default, public, protected, private, and so on. Two, non-access modifiers, which include final, abstract, strictfp, and so on. We will be looking into more details about modifiers in the next session. Java variables. A variable is an identifier that is declared in a method and stands for a value within that method. Each value is allowed to change within the method, unlike constants that is value do not change. Variables are names given to blocks of the computer's memory, which are also used to store values. There are different types of variables in Java programming language. 1. We have the local variables. 2. We have the class variables, which is also known as the static variables. And 3. We have the instance variables, which are also known as non-static variables. Java arrays. Arrays are objects that store multiple variables of the same type. However, an array itself is an object on the heap. We will look into how to declare, construct, and initialize in the upcoming chapters of this course. Java enums. Enums were introduced in Java 5.0. Enums restrict a variable to have one of only a few predefined values. The values in this enumerated list are called enums. With the use of enums, it is possible to reduce the number of bugs in your code. Example. If we consider an application for a fresh juice shop, it will be possible to restrict the glass size to small, medium, and large. This will make sure that it will not allow anyone to order any size other than small, medium, or large. Example of enums. You can see the program that is shown on the screen. The enumerated list includes small, medium, large. So we can copy this program and paste it in a notepad or textpad, any text editor. So let us demonstrate how it works. First of all, open your notepad or any other text editor that you want to use, and then write this program. In this case, we will copy it and paste in a text editor and then run the program and see what it will give us. Remember that the enumerated list, you have juice.size, so which is large. When you run this program, it will now print size plus juice.size. So the enumerated list that will be printed is large. Let us run it and see if we are correct. Remember that now we have been able to copy the code and insert it in the text editor. So the next thing we will do will be to run the program, but before we run it, we want to save it with this class name. So we copy the class name, we click on File, click on Save As, we press Ctrl V to insert it on the desktop. So you can see we will save it to the desktop. We click on Save. So once that is done, you will see that the name has changed. You click on Tools again, click on Compile Java. you can see that 2 completed with exit code 1, which means that this program has a problem. So let's see what the problem is. The problem that we have is in the public class FreightJuice test. So this means that we saved this program with FreightJuice instead of public class, the class name, which is the FreightJuice test. So what we will do will be to resave this program. You right click, select it, right click on it, click on copy, then go to file, click save as, then Ctrl V. So FreightJuice test. Once that is done, click save. When you click save, click on tools menu again and click on compile Java. We see that 2 completed successfully, which means we have been able to save this work with the class name. The next thing will be to click on the tools menu and then click on run Java application. So you can see that the size is large, as you can see in the code. This is it, the enumerated list that we have here. We have the FreightJuice size dot what large. Okay, so this is how to demonstrate the enumerated list, which is known as enums in Java programming language. So the output of the program we have just written is size large. Note, enums can be declared as their own or inside a class. Methods, variables, constructors can be defined inside enums as well. So you will learn about this in details as we proceed in this tutorial. Java keyword. These are Java reserved words that are recognized by Java language and may not be used as a constant or a variable or any other identifier names. These Java keywords include abstract, assert, boolean, break, byte, case, catch, char, for character, class, constant, continue, default, do, double, else, enum, extends, final, finally, float, for, go to, if, implements, import, instance of, integer, interface, long, native, new, package, private, protected, public, return, short, static, strict FP, super, switch, synchronized, this, true, truth, transient, try, void, volatile, while. So these are the reserved words in Java programming language, and any of these cannot be used as a variable or constant. If that is done, then the program will throw an error message informing the programmer that a reserved word should not be used as a variable. Comments in Java. Java supports single line and multi-line comments, very similar to C and C++. All characters available inside any comment are ignored by Java compiler. This means that the comments that you insert in your program are not executed by the compiler. They are treated as just mere comments, or they are just used for documentation of the program. So the compiler ignores it and then executes other code in your programs. Single line comment begins with double forward slash. You can see the double slash. While multi-line comment begins with forward slash, asterisk, and ends with asterisk, forward slash. Let us see how you can insert comment in your program. As you can see in our Hello World program that we demonstrated earlier in this practice, we have comments in the program. The first one is the multi-line comment. As you can see, the compiler ignores everything here. So this is my first Java program. This will print Hello World as the output. This is an example of multi-line comments. So you can use this comment to state the function of the program or the purpose of the program, the programmer, the date the program was written, and the other important information that needs to be explained to the user or to others that we may adopt this program or may want to modify the program in future. So, as you can see, this is a single line word comment. This is an example of single line comment. You use double forward slash to include a single line comment. So single line comment, you can use it to describe what a program, a line of code does. So we are going to copy this program and then run it and see what happens. So as you can see, we have the multi-line comments here. And the comments in Java using TextPad is shown in green color. So you can see this is my first Java program. This will print Hello World as the output. This is an example of multi-line comments, and you close it asterisk forward slash. Then in this section, we are trying to state that this is a single line comment. Why this is multi-line comment. So this is an example of a single line comment, or it could be written as well like this, forward slash asterisk. This is an example of a single line comment, then you must close it. But if you are using double forward slash, you don't need to close it. Even if you close it, it will treat it as a comment. Now, you can also use single line comment to describe a line of code. Like in this case, we have this prints hello world. This closes the main method. Or you can use forward slash asterisk, this closes the class. So when you run this program, you find out that Java compiler does not execute comments. That is why you are seeing it in green color, telling you that this is a comment. Comments are useful, especially when you want to document a program so that others will be able to understand it when maybe if they want to upgrade it or if they want to use it to teach others or to learn what each line of code does in a program, or it will give an information about the overall purpose of the program. So let us run this program. Before we run this program, you will understand that my first Java program is the class name, but what we have here is fresh juice test. So we are going to save this as my first Java program. If we run it without saving it, it will indicate that there is an error because the fresh juice test.java is not the same as my first Java program. So we click on File menu, we click on Save As. Then, before them, instead of typing it, we can select it, right click and click Copy. It's not a must, you can type the name if you want, but we are trying to save time. Click on Save As, Ctrl V. You will see that we already have it, have my first Java program. So what we do will be to click on Save and then do my first Java program.java already exists. Do you want to replace it? I click yes. So once that is done, you will see that we now have our name, the program file name showing here, and you have the program class name. Then we click on tools, click on compile Java. So two completed successfully. We now click on tools again and click on run Java application. So you can see hello world printed. So it did not print the comments. It only printed the code, which is system.out.println hello world. So this is a typical example of what comment in a program. So let's continue with the concept definition. In Java, classes can be derived from classes. Basically, if you need to create a new class, and here is already a class that has some of the code you require, then it is possible to derive your new class from the already existing code. This concept allows you to reuse the fields and methods of the existing class without having to rewrite the code in a new class. Remember that we are addressing inheritance in class. In this scenario, the existing class is called the superclass, and the derived class is called the subclass. Interfaces in Java. In Java language, an interface can be defined as a contract between objects on how to communicate with each other. Interfaces play a vital role when it comes to the concept of inheritance. An interface defines the methods a deriving class, which is known as subclass, which we normally use, or which may appear in your program depending on what you want to do, but the implementation of the methods is totally up to the subclass. Java object and classes. Java is an object-oriented language. As a language that has the object-oriented feature, Java supports the following fundamental concepts: polymorphism, inheritance, encapsulation, abstraction, classes, objects, instance, method, and the message passing. In this chapter or this course, we will look into the concepts, classes, and objects. Then, what is an object? Objects have states and behaviors. Example, a dog has states, color, name, breed, as well as behaviors such as wagging the tail, barking, eating, and so on. An object is an instance of a class. Then, what is a class? A class can be defined as a template or blueprint that describes the behavior or state that the object of its type supports. Objects in Java. Let us now look deep into what are objects. If we consider the real world, we can find many objects around us: cars, dogs, humans, and so on. All these objects have a state and a behavior. If we consider a dog, then its state is name, breed, color, and the behavior. And the behavior is barking, wagging the tail, running, and so on. If you compare the software object with a real-world object, they have very similar characteristics. Software objects also have a state and a behavior. A software object state is stored in fields, and behavior is shown via methods. A class is a blueprint from which individual objects are created. Following is a sample of a class. You can see public class, dog, then what is the string name, breed. Age of the dog is integer, then color of the dog is also string. Void, barking. So the dog can bark, the dog can be hungry, and the dog may be sleeping. So in these methods, you can now write programs that will demonstrate the barking or other similar behavior of the dog as regards to barking. Then we also have the hungry. If the dog is hungry, what happens? You can write code for that. If the dog is sleeping, what happens? So you can see that a class is a blueprint from which individual objects are created. Then, what are local variables? Variables define inside methods, constructors, or blocks are called local variables. The variable will be declared and initialized within the method, and the variable will be destroyed when the method has completed. So other methods may not see the variable that you declared inside another method unless that variable is a global variable or public variables. Then instance variables as variables within a class but outside any method. These variables are initialized when the class is instantiated. Instance variables can be accessed from inside any method, as we said earlier, constructor or blocks of that particular class. Then a class variable is a variable declared within a class outside any method with the static keyword. So to declare such a class variable, you use the word static to begin it. A class can have any number of methods to access the value of various kinds of methods. In the above dog example, barking, hungry, and sleeping are methods. Following are some of the important topics that need to be discussed when looking into classes of the Java language. Every class has a constructor. If we do not explicitly write a constructor for a class, the Java compiler builds a default constructor for that class. Each time a new object is created, at least one constructor will be invoked. The main rule of constructors is that they should have the same name as a class. A class can have more than one constructor. Let us look at this example of a constructor. You have the public class Puppy, then you have the object, and you now have a constructor with one parameter name. Let us now discuss the error types in Java programming language. We have the syntax error or compile errors. These are errors caught at compile time. That is when Java compiler is compiling your program and discovers any syntax error. Syntax error is an error that occurs when the rule of the language is violated. So once it encounters syntax error, your program will not run. For example, in the previous program we wrote, that is Hello World program, we will go back to that program and alter a word and then compile it and see what Java will tell us. So let's go back to that textpad, that program written in textpad. So as you can see, public class, my first Java program. Let us add programs. Let us add S. And then let us remove, you know that each Java program will end with semicolon. Let us delete this semicolon. And now run this code, this program. We click on compile Java. So you can see tools completed with exit code 1. So we now go back to see the exit code 1. The code is that it's telling us that there is an error, which is semicolon expected. So we go back to this place and add a semicolon. So once that is done, we save the program. We go back to tools and click on compile. we also have an error. So we go back. It's telling us that the error is occurring in the class name. As you can see, my first programs instead of my first program. So what we will do is that we go back here and remove that S. So we save it, click on Tools menu again, and click on Compile Java. You will see that it has completed successfully, which means that there is no error in this program now. So this is called a syntax error. When you violate the rules of the program, when you delete a keyword, or when you use a keyword as a variable, and so on and so forth. So these are called the compile word or syntax errors. Let us continue with the other types of errors. So we also have runtime error. This means that something bad happens at runtime. Java breaks these into errors and exceptions. So the runtime error is the error that occurs when there is no syntax error, there is no compile error, but as the program is running, it encounters a problem. For example, if you write a program that you're supposed to enter a letter of the alphabet, and you now enter the number, it will display the runtime error, informing the user that something bad has happened. Instead of the user to enter letter or character, the user is entered a number. So these are runtime errors. Runtime error could also occur when there is division by zero. For example, you wrote a program that divides numbers, and that program, instead of the user to enter a number, a positive number, the user entered zero, or entered a negative number, or the user entered a large number that may be difficult for the compiler to divide. So this kind of error occurs at runtime, and you must have a method of arresting the error so that the user will know exactly what he or she is required to do when using the program. Then we also have the logic error. Program compiles and runs, but does not do what you intended or wanted. So this means that logic errors are those errors that occur when you write a program. The program will execute successfully, but the output of the program may be wrong. For example, instead of using a plus sign for addition of numbers, you use negative sign. So instead of saying sum equals to A plus B, you use sum equals to A minus B. This will run, but instead of giving you the added number, the result of the numbers added, it will give you a result of numbers subtracted. So this is called logic error. Logic error is different from syntax error or runtime error because it will compile. But because there is an error, the programmer did not write the program to bring out the correct output. We will also consider the basic features in Java programming language. We have the data types, which include primitives, classes, and objects, expressions and operators, control structures, arrays, methods, programming for correctness, which includes pre and post conditions, assertions, and so on and so forth. Let us consider Java data types. Data types specify the different sizes and values that can be stored in the variable. There are two types of data types in Java programming language. We have number one, primitive data types. The primitive data types include Boolean, char, that is character, char, byte, short, int, long, float, and double. While the non-primitive data types are classes, interfaces, and arrays. You can see the data type here. You have the data type, we have primitive and non-primitive data types. So the non-primitive data types include the string, arrays, and so on. While the primitive data type include Boolean, and Boolean is Boolean, true or false. That is, you use it for logic, logic constructs. Then we have the numeric data types. We have the character data type, which is char, C-H-A-R. And we also have the integral data type, which includes integer and floating point. So for integer data type, we have byte, you have short, you have integer, you have long. While the floating point data type includes float and the double. Let us discuss the identifiers. Then, all Java components require names. Names used for classes, variables, and methods are called identifiers. All identifiers should begin with a letter, A to Z, capital, or A to Z, lowercase letters. Currency, that is currency character, which is dollar, or an underscore. After the first character, identifiers can have any combination of characters. A keyword cannot be used as an identifier. Most importantly, identifiers are case sensitive. Examples of legal identifiers include age, dollar salary, underscore value, underscore one, underscore value. Why examples of illegal identifiers are 1, 2, 3, ABC? Because you are beginning it with a number, and the next one is the salary, minus salary. So minus sign cannot be used, or any other special character be used to start an identifier, except the dollar sign and the underscore. We continue with the identifiers. Variables, we have lowercase with internal words capitalized. So, example is honking big variable name. This is just a variable name, it's not a keyword. So, as you can see, variables can start with lowercase. Then you have internal capitalized words, B for big, variable for V for variable, and N for name. So these are the internal words capitalized. Why the variable will start with a lower case. Then we have constants, all caps with underscore between internal words. Let us see an example. This is an example of a constant, another honking big identifier. So you can see the underscore in between each of the words. So this is a single variable name for constants. Then classes must start with capital letter. Internal words capitalized, all others lowercase. Let's see an example. Can you see? For classes, it must start with a capital letter, like in H, while the other ones, honking, lowercase, long, you have capital letter L, class, you have capital letter C, and name, you have capital letter N. So you can now see that each of these have its own way of writing the variable names. There are two data types available in Java, as we said earlier, primitive data types and reference or object data types. Primitive data types are predefined by the language and named by a keyword. while reference or object data types are reference variables, are variables created using defined constructors of the classes. Example of a primitive data type, we have the byte. Byte data type is an 8-bit signed 2's complement integer. Minimum value is -128, that is -2^7. Maximum value is 127 inclusive, that is 2^7 -1. Default value is 0, and so on and so forth. So example of a byte is 100. You can byte A is equals to 100, then byte B is equals to -50. So we have declared A as a variable that we hold a byte 100, while B is a variable that we hold a byte -50. Remember that it is within the range of -128 to 127. We have short. As you can see, you can have short number range. For example, the S is a variable declared as short, which holds 10,000, while R is a variable declared as short, which holds -20,000. So short data type is a 16-bit signed 2's complement integer. Runs between the minimum value is 1-32,768, while the maximum value is 32,767. We have the integer data type. So when you declare a variable as an integer, it means that it is holding a whole number. It will not hold a decimal number. So any integer, any data type, any variable declared as integer data type must hold a whole number. So you can see that the default value is 0, while integer data type is a 32-bit signed 2's complement integer. The minimum value is -2,147,483,648 to 2,147,482,647.